Hi Venkat, I'm Raghu.
Hey.
What do you do?
I work for Oracle.
How long have you been working for Oracle?
7 years.
Okay, juniors, right there.
Oh, it's a huge crowd.
But yeah, I wanted a smaller setting this time. Also, this is not a topic which will interest everyone. So, especially people who have been hurt by it.
You work for?
No, I work with Hacker Earth now. So I used to work for a media company called Your Story, yourstory.com. Go read it. It's a brilliant place if you want a startup. That's a really nice back cover for, what is it, Moto G or Moto X? Yeah. It's fluorescent. It's just big on my eyes. So I used to write for Your Story. I've covered about 500-600 startups, written about them over a span of 1.5 years. And I think I know enough about startups now to work in one. I'm a product manager at Hacker Earth. So go check out Hacker Earth also.
What is it? Hacker.net?
Hacker Earth.
Yeah. What do you do?
I'm a product manager. I help on defining the roadmap for three of our products.
What does the company do?
We help other companies find good developers. So, yeah, technical recruiting firm, a technology company for technology companies. That should be a tagline, man. You know what the best bit is? There are only about 7 of us, so it can be the tagline now. That'll be a bit about what I'm going to talk about here. And 3 minutes ago. Why don't you guys tell me a little about yourself? What were your motivations to come to this talk particularly? You came last, so you have to talk.
Yeah, sure, so I'm actually a speaker. I'm speaking on the Hoysala temples, actually.
Interesting.
Yeah,
I was at Hampi recently. I thought it was pretty cool.
But that is not a Hoysala temple. So
see, now I should attend your talk.
More on that plug later. So, I write for a couple of journals, newspapers, Hindu, Technical.
But you work for Oracle, right?
I work for Oracle. This is a freelance writer.
Oh, pretty cool.
I travel a lot, so I write. And culture was something that I follow, heritage, culture, and everything. So, it looked interesting. Let's see how it goes.
Unfortunately, I'm going to disappoint you.
is
about organizational.
How do you define culture? The effort behind culture.
Cool. That's not completely that.
Maybe we'll find out how disappointing it is.
I've seen you before. You're one of the angry guys. Oh, you look similar to one of them. So, it's fun, right? Every bar camp, I make a lot of friends and some people who despise me. Absolutely. So the first talk that I spoke about was how the caste system's completely messed up, okay, and how it's been misinterpreted over generations and all that. That was, as you can imagine, kind of everyone got there. The second one was why people become entrepreneurs. The reason behind why people become entrepreneurs. That was the most safe one. I didn't get murdered. The third one was the worst. Why you shouldn't work at a startup. That was the point. I would say everything that's wrong with it and you would still want to join a startup. So that was fun, and now it's about culture. I'll tell you why, because now it's 4 years since I started working. Some kind of young, I might look old, but 4 years I've always worked at startups of varying sizes, 200, 300 employees to one employee to 30 odd employees to again 7, and at least two out of three places here, I've helped define the culture of certain companies. Sometimes it's worked, sometimes it hasn't. And
so, your culture
by
means you
organizational culture. Yeah, but with your organizational culture. So that's because it's such an overused term. You know, have you heard of the company called Zappos? Tony Hsieh came on screen once and he said the most important thing about hiring at Zappos and culture is culture. You might be a genius at what you do, but if you're not a culture fit, we're not going to hire you. So they were rejecting Stanford grads, Harvard grads, just because these guys weren't culture fits. And that kind of touched a raw nerve with a lot of entrepreneurs, and the culture fit as a word became very easy to throw around. Okay, and everyone's like, oh, this is our culture, you don't fit in our culture, this is that. okay, what is it? What do you mean when you say culture, right? And there is usually a very vague answer around culture. And which is sad because organizational culture is a defined science. Okay, and organizational culture has, there are many, many great scholars who have written papers on it. This talk is not going to be academic anyway, but you know, for something that defined and something that's still that misunderstood at this time, I think there should be some light that's shed on it. So that was my motivation for the talk. Yay. And we have 5 minutes. I'm sorry, I'm kind of a stifler for time. I'll start exactly at 9:45.
Projector?
Yes, sir.
Any problems?
No.
Not yet. You have got the correct answer.
Not yet. See, that was the keyword.
Yes. I was asking any problems.
You said not yet.
Not yet. So, have you checked with anyone?
What? I got it.
Oh, you got it.
I got it.
So, it's not fresh to the input.
No,
is
it? It's connected.
It's connected. Let's try switching the input.
Come on, that and go. Is it 11 or
13? What? 13. I thought this was the best thing that's happened to my life. I have
going
to
make it happen.
I have to because I've burnt a lot of money on it. It's funny, no? Apple kind of builds the most ridiculously expensive products and you still buy it.
I don't.
Hmm?
I don't.
You will.
I'm not.
Wait for it.
You need to rephrase that statement.
Why?
They build nice products and then they make it ridiculously expensive.
There are nice products that are not ridiculously expensive also. Like the Moto G, for example. I bought the Moto G. I'm so happy with it.
That's the way they work, right? So the pricing is a key point. If you price it more, you can get a, you know, Zappos lighter. You can also get a 15 rupees lighter. There is a statement along with it. So, you know, when you go and present it, you carry a brand image along with it.
It's not consistent through all of their products. If you look at their iPad, right? The iPad mini is 21,000 rupees, which is roughly the price range of any other decent high-end tablet that you're looking at.
Things are changing, right? Things are changing in the ecosystem.
Yeah, there is a 5.5-inch iPhone that's coming out. What is wrong with you? I thought only Samsung was mad. You know, this is like, you should stop being...
It's more like...
Those are weapons, actually. Take them. Cut people's head off. Is someone here with a big tablet-sized phone? Because I saw some people keep quiet on
that. You've seen it already. Pop out of
the or it'll be in the hand. I've never got the point of big phones. Yeah, 4.7 inches is perfect.
Right?
Dude, you took me seriously, didn't you? Hi. You are?
Anna.
What do you do, Anna?
I'm currently a blogger.
Nice. Where do you blog?
On Tumblr. I'm writing about innovation in New York City.
Pretty cool. I was a blogger once. It's a hard life. Seriously, man, at Your Story, we used to write like 2 to 3 articles a day. That was fun.
It's my excuse to be ready. Pretty much.
But yeah, I've got a few years. 5 minutes more. You have to bear with my nonsense for this for this long.
Nonsense only for 5 minutes.
Yes, I hope so.
You mean
I hope so. But what's not nonsense, it can also be boring, you know, so it's a trade-off. Who else is speaking here today? So you're speaking on the Vaisala, right? What about it? As in, give us a little...
So, the idea is to make you look at temples that are from a different perspective. Things that you don't generally see, and talk about the Vaisala temples. So these are the kind of one of most beautiful temples that you'll ever see in this part of the country. So I'll be running you through some of them. Lots of pictures.
How do you define that? Like, what makes it beautiful?
So you should probably come and attend.
I will, but yeah. So I'm from Madurai, which is a temple city.
I'm a Chennai.
Oh, you're a Chennai. So in Madurai, there's this really 400-year-old temple called the Meenakshi Amma temple. It's beautiful. So after that, I really don't. And also, I'm probably biased.
So yeah, I am on the quest from
Nice, man. It's nice that you found something that you're really interested in. I want to.
I was just looking at that category.
Yeah, no, I got the converter.
So here in Bhakan, you will see if you ask for want to, right? Do you want to go climb Everest? Yes. Do you want to do this? Yes. You can yes for everything. It's a rhetoric question, actually.
Ruchika.
No, the reason is I have a mobility by putting bicycle. So, but I came late, so I didn't get a slot.
You should do one of those impromptu things, right? Like.
So if this session is boring, right?
You can take over. Thank you, man. Thanks so much.
Jokes about halfway. No, that's how it works.
Jokes
so if he's boring, you know, if we bored, push him off when you're done.
If you don't do running and cycling, you can think of starting running and cycling. It's very helpful in your life. During your stressful times, during your free time, you learn a lot about life, actually. The philosophical part of life, the search behind finding yourself, coming out of this materialistic world. You work, you earn money, everything apart. But once you start running and cycling, you are out of the world, moving out from others, and you and your bicycle, you and running. So try it out. Just go for a run. Don't talk much about how to do it. Just go for it in the early morning once you wake up, if you like it.
You obviously run.
Yeah, yeah.
A cycle.
I took 6 months mobility by foot and bicycle. So I was walking by foot, bicycle inside the city, wherever I go.
Nice.
Then I did 800 kilometer tour of 10 days, bicycling tour.
How long did that take?
It's an 8-day tour, actually. And I finished with the Mumbai Marathon, 42 kilometers. Then I broke my collarbone. Now
you should
I'm
fractured. So those are very bad injuries, right? You can't lift your hand up like this.
You won't feel the pain.
Until you do something.
So, shut up?
Yes. I still have 2 minutes, but for the call. 8 is not what I wanted there. So, I think for the people who came early, I spoke about why I'm talking about this. It's a very overused term. Culture is very spoken about in terms of in small companies, in large companies. Culture is the most important thing according to some of the brightest CEOs that are out there in the world today. But what is it, right? And it was, that was the whole aim of this talk. I wanted to shed some light on people who have set good examples of culture and defined it for other companies to follow. The first thing when someone says culture, right? The rave is this guy. It's about sanskar. but what is it, right? Like, I thought this was really, he's a very funny guy. Okay. It's, as soon as you think about culture in an Indian context, you think of puja, you think of the way someone dresses, you think of a choir in a church, art, monuments, museums, dance form, music, and all those sort of things, right? So, it's all those things, okay? And essentially, how I would, you know, it's great. Everybody likes to be associated with something cultural. We all want to learn how to do Bharatanatyam. We all want to know, we all like how we all want to run and cycle and things like that. There are cultural things that we all want to do. But what is it? Let's define it, right? It's the way we do things. Like Indians do certain things in certain ways. It'll be completely different to another geography or another country or even another state, for example, in India. So just essentially how we go about doing certain things. It's the way we behave, and it's the butt of so many jokes that Russell Peters has cracked on Indians. The way we shake our head, the accent, the way we walk, the way we dress, all those sort of things. Is culture. It's the wisdom of, you know, the older generations that is passed on to the younger ones. We often look to our elders right? And the way we live is often defined by them, and it changes with time, obviously, but a large part of culture is what is given to us by our ancestors. And the best example, and this is probably more on a company's standpoint, it's what you do when no one's looking. That is real culture. You know who said that? How many of you have heard of this organization called Southwest Airlines? It's a US-based intercontinental airline service. And Herb Keller, that company is known for many, many good things in terms of human resource practices. And I will talk about it later on.
This was in the context of integrity.
No.
Integrity,
yeah, he did, but no, he did say this in culture. This is how he defined culture. I'm quite sure it was culture. Yeah. So he said, it's what you do when no one's looking. And I'll tell you why. Like, for example, if you're an organization that has to change the way you behave when you're addressing the media or when somebody external is coming to your place, then maybe that's not very good culture. But essentially, that's how he defined it as. So, whatever you see in terms of culture, right, it starts at homes, at companies, at countries. Okay, it's all over the place. And if probably there was an alien world, the earth would have a singular sort of culture. But my focus of this talk is going to be on what culture means in a company, right? Culture is derived from core values. Okay, like the patrons of a company decide my company will stand for these things, right? So I'll give out an example of the sort of things. Like, there was a company that said, you know, we will base our culture on these four things: integrity, passion, excellence, and communication. Which company do you think said that? It's good things, right? Anyone?
Enron. Company says three of them.
Yeah.
You said something.
Enron.
Yep. It was exactly Enron. And we know all what a scam job that turned out to be. Okay, to me, I find that culture is not what you say, it's what you do. It's more behavioral, right? It's completely this way. It's all right to walk, you know, talk. We've also got to walk the talk, right? So to me, culture is what you do. And I have three stories on it. I've had the chance to work at very diverse places. There is a small town in Tamil Nadu called Kovilpatti. How many people here know of Kovilpatti? You would know, right? Yeah. There was a small IT services company that served the US Navy and stuff like that there. And they were starting a sales project for which I joined, right? Now, Kovilpatti is the typical tier 3 conservative mindset. And I was this typical city bred kid. Okay, I studied in Madurai, but lived all my life in Bangalore and, you know, abroad and all those sort of things. So I was like, how am I ever going to fit into this place? People are going to be completely different. And to an extent, I thought it would be like this, a foreigner standing in the middle of all of these people. But you know what? What I found out was that I fitted in perfectly. I blended in like without any difficulty. Yes, I knew the local language, which was Tamil at the point of time. But then the way I thought, from the way I dressed to the way I conducted my life, was completely different to my co-workers, my immediate co-workers. How did I fit in? So to me, I thought, one of the things that I did right in that place was that I worked very hard, okay? And secondly, the project that I started flourished very well, and it went on to raise a series of funding, and, you know, it was a very good story. So it was a very accepting thing. So I thought culture isn't confined to a set of boundaries. Yes, they have some foundations, but then it can be anything. Anything that contributes to the betterment of that company can be included in the culture. Now, when I went back to the company to discover it, my work ethic or ethos was there in that place. A part of me has now become become a part of that culture, right? So culture is what you do for the betterment of the company. That is acceptable. If it's in that acceptable range of thing, that will also become culture. It was the first biggest thing that I learned. My second stint was a complete waste of time. I worked with a singular entrepreneur who wanted to do some very high, you know, different things, and I was like, man, I'm going to be the first employee here as well, and I'm going to do great things. It failed horribly. Okay, like in 8 months, I didn't know what I did in the last 8 months. But I'd learned enough about startups, and I went to your story and said, you know what, I want to write. Because I thought, hey, you know, I, I can write, and it'll be great fun. So the founder of that company said, yep, come on in and we'll write. I had no idea what I was signing up for. And that's where I learned about this graph. Okay. How many people here think stress is a bad thing? Just because I'm showing this graph doesn't mean that it's... So, well, bad news, you need stress. Okay. I never knew I could get so much work done if I was in some sort of stress, right? Hello.
Hey.
What's your name?
Utsav.
Hi, Utsav.
Hi.
So, the company, yourstory.com, the place where I work, it was probably the most hectic time of my life. You get in the morning at 9, you focus on the stories you want to write for that day, track entrepreneurs, track news, you have a list of stories to write, you finish that out, and then the next thing you know, you're interviewing 3 more people in the evening. Once you're done with that, you're then reviewing everything that you need to do. And then you work on your 20% projects that you're trying to, like a new series that you're trying to put out, do groundwork for an event. And all those sort of things, I was realizing I was working 16, 17 hours a day with very little time for myself, right? What I realized is that under stress, I was doing more things than I thought I could ever, that I ever could, right? So a culture which keeps everybody happy all the time is not very good. A culture that keeps everybody unhappy all the time is also not very good. If you're not stressed at all, you're not going to be working at all. If you're too overly stressed, you're going to break down at some point, right? There was an optimal point which I discovered, which every company culture should imbibe, right? There has got, and this is where the whole accountability and all that sort of thing comes in. And I find that if there is an optimal level of stress, you work very well. Now, the third company that I joined, where, and it was probably the biggest risk that I've ever taken, and it has paid off. I was tired of writing a lot. And I said, you know what, I want to now work for a startup. And this was fun, right? At Your Story, you will write about things that companies should do. So I said, hey, have you tried these things? And all those are great ideas. But then when the entrepreneur comes and asks you, you know what, all that's fine, but have you done this? I like, not really. You know? So it obviously meant that I needed more operational experience. And I said, I'm going to join a company in a marketing product sort of role. And I picked up a company called HackerEarth. Now, HackerEarth, interestingly, was a company that worked out of Your Story. They were, in a way, worked out of the Your Story office. So I knew the founders very well. I went up to him and said, you know what, I want a job. I have these suggestions for your company. They were valid. And he said, you know what, why don't you join? And that's where I learned my third lesson. Brutal honesty. Have you seen American Idol or X Factor or any one of these guys? Have you seen this guy talking about Simon Cowell? Talk about contestants. It's like, that was absolutely horrendous. And for anyone who's singing, it's bad. You shouldn't say things like that. But that sort of honesty is what I heard here. At Your Story, you know, yes, there was pressure, but people weren't mean to each other, right? People weren't, you know, very bad. They weren't. That's okay. Come on. In. What's your name?
Geet.
Hi, Geet. Geet K. Damn it. So I saw a name on the people who wanted to attend it. So the third lesson which I learned here is that usually when people are being mean to you, you would think that that's a bad place to be in, right? But if it's a company that, if you bought together a set of individuals that you can be mean to at work, I mean, for example, I put out an idea and it was bad, okay? Honestly, it was really, really bad. And one of the founders came up to me and said, dude, you're acting like an incompetent asshole. You don't want to hear that when you're working at a company, when you're working at a startup, right? But that's exactly what I heard. And I knew I was being an incompetent asshole. And then you work from there and try to, you know, become better and all those sort of things. And the same thing happens between me and somebody else. And what I found out is if you can be brutally honest with your coworkers, you are, and still at the end of the day be friends, you're creating a great work environment, at least in the early stages of a company. Have you noticed singers today, the music industry? I'm a musician myself, and I liken a lot of things to the music industry. Back in the day, in the 60s, in the 70s, do you remember the hit songs of those times? You would have people like Sting, you'll have people like Queen, you'll have people like Eagles. They wrote complicated stuff, right? The sort of things that intimidates you when you look at it. But when you listen to it, it was great, right? Have you seen the stuff now? Your Justin Bieber's and your Selena Gomez's and what's her name? The lady on a wrecking ball. I forgot
Miley
her
Cyrus.
Name. Miley Cyrus, yeah. What I feel is that, you know, people are getting their way now. People are getting their way. They put out shit, people accept it. Okay? Back in the day, there was you need the people who have seen 100 of you to be sitting at the top of that company.
Aren't you kind of negating your own opinion? The culture is what people do. So, you know, for a, you might call it a shit. Someone else might, you know, it's nirvana for them.
No, as a from a musician's perspective.
No, that's what you think, right?
No.
They are musicians, right?
No, they're not. They're production artists.
So
they're not musicians.
That's your view.
No, that's the reality.
No, that's your view.
Why do you say it's my view?
You can ask anyone. This is
okay, how many people here think Miley Cyrus is shit?
That is an opinion.
That's an opinion.
Okay, fine.
What I'm trying
I
to
will
do
quant-
is, I'm not, what I'm trying to do is you're trying to push your opinion and you're making it a fact, which is wrong.
Hear me out.
No, you have been
I get your point.
You can also
talk. No, I get your point.
Yeah.
You're trying to say that it's people's preferences, they should listen to what they want.
Culture
right?
Is, you know, the way you're defining this, you're pushing your opinion to a fact, which is wrong.
Let me speak it up,
yep.
Right? My point is that a song with 17 different chord progressions, a song that will have one chord progression per line, a song which has...
people who listen to this, you know, I don't know anything about chord. Do you think I'm least bothered about it?
You
For
will.
Me, it should be pleasant.
You will be.
Then you are not on the same plane, you should not be having this discussion.
That's
because
exactly.
Your appreciation of music is a totally on different plane.
Exactly.
For example, when you were talking about Miley Cyrus, and I knew that they are all four chord songs. You know,
exactly.
Four chord songs.
Yeah.
So they are all at one level.
So
but now you cannot have this discussion because your appreciation of music... I don't want to say high or low or something else. But
no, what I'm
trying
to say is I'm not going deeper into a particular topic. What I'm trying to say is
I'm like, okay,
liking
maybe.
Liking or disliking a thing is a matter of opinion. You know, it's your opinion, it's
okay.
Your perspective.
Okay,
you cannot push saying that this is Miley Cyrus, you have to keep listening to her. It's not. There are some amazing post-rock groups even now who make amazing songs you wouldn't have even heard. Post-rock, have you heard of post-rock genre?
Just give me a minute. My point is I'm likening music, the quality of music to quality of work. Right? I would
but
still...
But actually, this is a very good point because I think, you see, even when it comes to opinions, I think...
Educated
opinions
are...
The opinions
yeah.
of people, only when they share the same level and appreciation of music that opinions matter. For example, I'm not musically educated, but I have a ear for music. So, when I tend to talk, when something seems very natural to me, and when somebody argues with that, and I find that they don't have a ear for music and you know, they don't appreciate music as well, I don't think we are on the same planes for even opinions to matter.
This is
I think that is a point he's made.
My
opinion is
that's
the
best example
the
for
company.
You. Know, I just want to give a practical example for your thing. Okay, I am an audiophile, I listen to music. So here in Bangalore, if you see, you can go to this PVR Innovative in Marthapalli, you can go to Meenakshi Mall in Marangatta Road. Compare the music, right, as in the sound system as such, both are completely different. People who genuinely like music, as in, it's not a great music system when compared to, you know, the usual Devon kind of amplifiers, etc., that you're talking about. But it's a subjective opinion.
I think your
opinion, you follow that.
You're deviating from that.
No.
You're talking about the quality of sound. I'm talking about the
quality
of the music.
What I'm trying to say is,
the sound that comes out of an amplifier, right?
Push an opinion to be a fact.
It is a fact in terms of quality of music. Maybe you like it. I
it's
have no problem.
Associated with it.
And that is what I'm saying.
Let the speaker speak.
No, it's all right.
No,
dude.
What are you doing?
No.
Okay, this is not the way it works.
No, yeah, we should
argue,
encourage this actually.
So. You argue.
Yeah.
It's not that argue per se, you express your opinion.
No.
Leave out the your opinion, I think.
No. I think it's good. It's good.
See,
and
like
we should have this.
He was keeping quiet. He spoke up. No, he made a very valid point.
Yeah.
No, it's good. I think we have to encourage these sort of things. If there's something that you don't agree upon, I recommend people to say this. But the point that I was making is that it's the same thing. If you make bad software, right, and you push it out, it is going to break at some point. It'll be the most beautiful looking thing that you've seen. It works for you. But if it breaks at some point, what's the point of doing it? What was the... You remember Miley Cyrus has been singing from 2005. Name one song from her from then.
No, I think if you continue on this,
forget
a lot of people here.
Yeah. Okay, so forget the part. The point I'm making is that if you have people who keep pushing you, because this guy is the same person who's going to be buying you dinner when everything works out fine, right? You need to have people who are pushing you all the time, and what it means is you're only going to get better. Now, when you're at a startup, how many people here want to work at a startup eventually? And why? Right. Anyone else?
A little more independence, more involvement in the building stages.
Cool. So let me give you something, okay? As if you're in the early team of a startup, what you do will define culture. You will be, your actions will define the culture of a company, right? And in that point, you've got to ask yourself, what is good culture? Do we have a definite answer for that? Go on.
Open, transparency.
Transparency. Anyone else? Anything else?
Respect.
Creativity. Respect.
Intuition.
Good. Anyone else?
Trust and honesty.
Cool. I'll quote the Dalai Lama on this. So, comes to likes and dislikes at the end. He said, whatever works for you. Right? You've got to figure out at your startup what works for you. Right? What is it, what kind of behavior is moving the company forward? What kind of actions? Hi, Ruchir. Everyone, Ruchir here. Ruchir, everyone.
Ruchir, everyone.
Sorry, thank you.
Ruchir has been making me run from there.
I was going to do it if my talk was not in this. Good job. Okay. So the point here is that, you know, whatever works for you, find out the things that are making your company move forward. If it's criticism that's making your company move forward, do more of that. If it's appreciation, if you found someone in your team, you appreciate him well enough, it brings the best out of him, do that more. If you feel that taking a break off after a very hard period of work brings the team together, do that. Figure out the things that work for the company. Figure out the things that is providing, that is making you X plus 2 on the next day, right? Figure out those things, and that makes the fundamental things about your culture. And all of these things come in: creativity, honesty, transparency, make people accountable for the work they do every day. Okay, and that makes them work harder? Fine. That should be one of the foundation beliefs of this. Nobody, no leader, right? And this depends on the kind of business that you're doing. If you're doing something that everybody has done, there are a set of beliefs and cultures that have worked. Okay, but with a startup, often you'll be doing things that nobody has done before, or something in an industry that is innovative, right? In these places, what you need to be figuring out is what works for you, and that'll work. And the best way to set a culture is this. Hire right. Hire, be absolutely choosy about whom you get on your team. You know, at an early stage startup, you're hiring all the time. You're absolutely, you're pitching your company to interesting people. You're pitching your company to the best talent that's out there and hoping that they would join you despite the fact that you can't pay them well enough, despite the fact that the work hours will be long, you'll have absolutely no social life. And despite everything against you, against your company, you're trying to sell this to them. And at the top of that, you've got to be extremely choosy about whom you bring on to the company. Because I'll tell you why. And I'll tell you a story around it. Again, I'll take the example of Southwest Airlines. JetBlue. JetBlue is another airlines company in the US that is fairly successful right now. The HR of that company said, you know, they would hire people. Okay, they would hire people in the early days and ask them, you know, what excites you? Why will you work for a company like us? What do you want this company to be? They would have the employees have a say in the culture. Okay? Once that works and they are A-list players, they're delivering all the time, they bring them into the HR department. They make sure that they are involved in hiring. How many of you have heard of Flipkart here? Right? Do you know the chief products officer, ex-chief products officer called Mekin Maheshwari? You've all heard of him. Do you know what he does now?
CRO.
Yeah, he's the chief people officer. So the whole thing is, and then we do business with them. So we know them pretty well. But the truth is, he was one of the early employees. He was one of, and probably recruiting is not even his skill. Okay, people are not even his skill, but he was one of the earliest employees of that place. And he knows the culture of Flipkart very well, right? He knows what kind of employees work well for him, what kind of employees don't work well for him. And he has been, and he's taken on that job, right? At startups, all of you have got to do that. Hire right and make sure those people are involved in setting a culture and eventually bringing this. And you know, you could just match them. These are the A-list players. Is his characteristics or her characteristics matching to the new recruit that I'm getting? Okay, so hire right. And feedback was something that I was talking about. Also, you know, there's a thing called, I've been talking about attitude for so long, right? That attitude is very important. You should have the right sort of attitude. You should have the right sort of beliefs. Have you heard Eric Raymond's 5 laws of hackers? Right, there are 5 principles, hacker attitudes. That is. And the 5th attitude, there are attitudes like sharing. You should be hostile to secrecy. You should think about the betterment of the world and all those sort of things. And the 5th one says, attitude is no substitute for competence. Do you get it? Attitude is no substitute for competence. Even the lady in the airline said, I can't hire a person who can't fly a jet. Right? Obviously, you need to have a best mix of someone who's really good at what he does, as well as have these attitudes. And at a startup, it is by far the most difficult thing to do. And as a company grows also, it is still the most difficult to do. Once a company reaches a stature of a SAP Labs or an Infosys or something like that, this becomes easier. You don't need to focus on culture that much. And you'll see that in large enterprises that it's dead. That's why companies like Google, Apple, and people like these, are huge, humongous businesses, do very well because they focus on their culture really, really hard. And that's the reason behind all of this fuss, right? Big companies die immediately. Like, there is no guarantee that a company will last forever, right? I remember Nokia about 5 years ago was probably the biggest thing in the market. Everybody had a Nokia phone. Come Samsung, come Android, come smartphone era. Nokia just couldn't, Nokia just couldn't adapt to it, right? There is no guarantee on how a company would live. And the things that you define at the early stage of a company helps you survive. Literally, that's why I've got this guy. Have you seen Man vs. Wild?
Yes.
Yeah. This guy takes survival to a whole new level, right? But honestly, it is that culture that you define in the early stages of your company that has helped you survive. I told you, right, whatever works for you. By work, I mean survive. You do something, it has helped you live the next 2 days. You do something, it's helped you live the next 5 or 6 days, right? Those are the things that will help you survive even when you're big. And the companies that focus on culture are the ones who live long. I'll end with that.
Huh? Nokia would have been a pretty good culture and a pretty good company. You go to Samsung, They have a different work culture.
Right.
You see the work culture of Samsung, it's a strict timing, strict way of living. They do everything on a very strict basis.
Okay.
Because why I'm saying you this thing is that I think about Nokia.
I defined culture as what works for you.
Sorry, but I would refer to
yeah, but you are using them as a bad case example. A company that has been actually able transform several times, like in their very long history, from rubber boots to mobile phones, and now they are doing also, like, they were the first Windows phones or whatever, you probably know that better. And you're using them as a negative example, right?
Not really. Samsung also has the same history. They started as a fish noodles company, and then they went on to smartphones. What I mean is that discipline was the culture here that helped them survive. The strict timings that you spoke about, the long hours, the making sure that productivity is at the highest. That is what ensured success for them.
The problem is there's a fallacy here. Because 3 years down the line, you might use Samsung as a... No, Samsung might not.
Absolutely.
Go the Nokia way, and then example might not hold.
So basically, the culture changes there.
Yeah, exactly. Whatever works for you. But then there is a focus on culture. That's all. That is true for most IT companies as such. But if you work, say, with Rolls-Royce, which makes aircraft engines, you cannot afford failure there.
Of course you can afford failure. You have to fail in order
when you're
to
making new things, yes.
New
but
engine.
No, when you're making new things, yes, And there's a test phase to that. Even the testing, right? The failure should happen at that space. There is no margin for error in those sort of things.
Since you mentioned aircraft, I would like to place a point here.
Yeah.
I heard from someone saying that when you join Ford companies those days, they take you to a workshop where you can see all the models which are failed ones.
Mm-hmm.
Then only they will show you can fail, but not with the same model.
Exactly.
So there it comes to a point, so failure is also possible.
Understood. When you're doing something new, you can do that. I strongly believe, because this is something that I've seen at work, right? That and maybe my view of companies is still in a very startup-y sort of mindset, so I could be wrong, as what you said, but your culture does define if you will survive or not. And yes, like for example, if creativity works for you, that's great. Like for example, a company like Google, you've got to be creative all the time, and that's helping you move forward and eventually survive the coming years as well. Companies are very finite lives, so at least that's my view.
But do you really want to be a survivor, or do you want to be a shaper of the future and shape what?
If you survive well, you will be a shaper of the future.
That's
my view. And eventually when everyone runs their own startup, maybe they will agree with this, maybe they'll be completely different about it. But there are very few cases where you can always be a shaper of the future. There's a lot of survival before you reach there. Sure, go on.
They were using Symbian, which was an open source kind of thing. They switched to Microsoft Windows in the middle of their when they were deciding directions, whether to go Android or Microsoft.
Right.
They chose Windows.
Hmm.
And they closed up the ecosystem.
Right.
Windows is a closed ecosystem.
Hmm.
So, and that's what caused that thing.
Also, who innovated first? Who innovated first?
I have one point.
Go on. Okay, cool.
I was listening to you guys. It's not the culture which makes them fail.
Right, go on.
So what I can talk about is the adaptation to the change.
Right.
Let's say I'm starting a company today. I can have a culture what I verify today. I can't have the same culture.
Understood, exactly. And adaptation to change is a culture, right?
Yeah.
It is a cultural mindset that has to be imbibed in your employees and from the leadership.
Then you have to keep changing your culture.
Exactly. I never said culture is constant.
Yeah. So, no, you said, right? You define your culture
on a set of beliefs and values.
A set of guys. That's what you said, right?
Exactly.
So, you start your culture when you have hired the guys, those they define it, right?
Hmm.
But let's say as you progress in your business, suddenly you take some wrong decision also.
Right.
And suddenly the culture is changed. You see everywhere the culture will change, right?
Right.
You have to survive in market. You can't do the same thing every day.
Exactly. That is some... So firstly, when you start a company like that, you have to know that it's a volatile market. Yes. And you'll need to know that adaptation should be one of your biggest points, that you'll have to adapt to change rapidly to survive in this space. Yes. That was not done at Nokia. That was my example. I'm not saying that Nokia didn't foster creativity. I didn't say that they did not foster innovation. Okay, and I didn't say that they didn't have a culture of excellence. Adaptation was a culture that they missed out on.
No, so you get the example of culture, and then you get the example of
Nokia. Okay. No, no, that's what I'm saying. Culture is not those things alone.
Yeah.
Right? Culture encompasses a lot of things. Behavior. Every behavior is a kind of culture. And if your employees have all of those good things, or if your leadership has all of those good things, and not the ability to adapt, that is a lacking in the culture, right?
So, yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying, like, let's say the day you are doing a startup, and then once you progress for 3 years, right, suddenly you become stable, and then the problem happens. It's not with Nokia, you see any company.
Exactly,
right?
Yeah.
Even if you see Google, right, they're surviving in some of the aspects.
Exactly.
And they are struggling to get number one. Certainly, it's adaptation to change is the truth. The change is the truth. Right?
Exactly.
And which you should bring to a culture or whatever you say.
In this industry. Yes, change is the truth universally, but in the software industry, more true than other industries as such. I mean, cars are not going to fly very soon, right? So.
No, we know that.
Not, I mean, there are prototypes of cars that fly, but to be adopted in large scales, there are many complications before which that
happens.
Talking
about all these things, you talked about Nokia and this. I have a doubt whether we are deviating from this topic of culture itself, because I see it as a strategy of a company. It's not about the culture of everyone in the company. Nokia survived, okay, fine. Now Google is going good. It's more like a strategy or the mindset of an individual where he sees a dream and others follow it. So how does culture fit into that?
That exactly, that following, okay, the action of following something, the dream that somebody set, is culture. It's behavior, right? It is some sort of behavior that you execute on a daily basis. That also encompasses. One of the four definitions was that, right?
Because you were talking about, you compare the company.
Exactly, and I believe that the ability to not change costs. Again, let's take the example of Apple, right? Until 2000, do you believe a CEO, one person, can change the fate of a company? One person.
Yes.
Right? It was not true until that point. And all Steve Jobs did was change the culture of that company. It's as simple as that. The mindset from, you know, we're not going to do these things. We're going to find out what made Apple sell back then. And we're going to try and do the same thing again. All that happened was a cultural shift in the head that made that survive, go from surviving. They were 3 months away from bankruptcy. The world's richest company was 3 months away from bankruptcy. That is probably the biggest leveler to me as such. Everybody survives at some level. And you can disagree with this, but I believe that the best survivors are leading the pack today. And Darwinism right there. I'm sorry, I mean, I don't...
Like this whole survivor thing, whatever, I try to understand where you're coming from.
You
have this huge competitive mindset of survival of the fittest and stuff like that, which, I mean, is scientifically proven, there is some background to it, but I think if you continue thinking like that, you will not survive, because even now in India,
why is survival such a bad thing?
People can, little grass is growing. A lot of people have access to jobs and stuff like that. Of course, a lot of people don't. But a life where you have a roof over your head, you have a TV, a computer, and stuff like that. Like, it's pretty normal for most of us. And so I personally don't have to worry that much about will I make it to the next day, right? And the same in my job. Like in my job, I want to grow as a person. I want to grow professionally, stuff like that. I don't want to be shouted as with brutal honesty, be shouted at and be what was that for a stupid idea to say? I want to be in an environment where I can actually say stupid ideas and people are like, that was awesome, thank you, Anna. We put it in the stupid corner, whatever, you know? But not scream at me being very condescending.
Okay, that again,
Sorry,
let me just answer that. Sorry. That's the millennial mindset, as you would call it, right? The person, you don't want to survive anymore, you want to live, and you move on. And I don't know whether that will be the reality. So there is a utopian mindset that this is how things should be, right? What you just defined as the ideal way of living. And then there is a dystopian mindset where you have everything's doom and gloom. And then there's a reality in between, right? I'm talking about that. By survival, I don't mean that we don't do the things that you just said right now.
When you talk about culture, you should strive for an environment where people actually can do excellent work and enjoy doing that excellent work.
Exactly, but that's
enjoy going to your work.
That's a very conscientious mindset. You have to be at a higher mind like that. Most people are not there yet. The mass of the human civilization is not there.
If you do presentations like that, then people won't get there.
I'm not an evangelist, right? I'm just presenting facts as they are, right? Will you disagree with me that everybody is ideal and the way the world is functioning is wrong? It's not an ideal world.
Could I add on to what you said?
Sure.
Like you said, right? If survival means being creative.
Go ahead, be creative. That's exactly what I mean.
Creative, you have to promote all the things that you just said, right? Then I think right now in today's world, survival is is the same thing as being creative. And to be creative,
absolutely,
you have to allow stupid ideas to even grow.
I agree.
So I think his point is right.
I agree with that.
You have to survive. And right now, surviving means being creative. And by being creative, you have to allow stupid ideas to grow.
It's the mindset that you've just told me about. It is not a bad thing. What, in fact, I would love to work in a similar place. But I have found that the best success, and this is empirical, I'm not talking about likes and dislikes, I'm talking about what I've seen in the past, that the people who pushed and pushed and pushed the hardest, okay, Steve Jobs again, an example, when the iPhone 4
it's,
had...
It's anecdotal, not empirical.
It's a, I feel it's empirical. I've seen this work over time.
No, did you do a study inside?
It's qualitative through
it's
my
semantic speech.
Right.
It's the anecdotal, your personal experience, right?
All right. Let's keep it there. Yeah. The example that I'm going to state now isn't. The product team has worked really hard, okay, on building the iPhone 4, the coolest looking, brilliant, most compact looking smartphone and most stylish looking smartphone in the world, right? Steve Jobs takes that thing and puts it in a tub of water and says, I can see bubbles out of that. Go build it again. That's pushing, and that's, would you like to see your hard work go down a fish tank? But that happened. And what did we end up with? Better products. Are you getting what I'm saying? So I feel that there needs to be that sort of harsh reality check every now and then.
Step up on that, right? Yeah. So if you imagine the same scenario, and imagine if the employees were allowed to actually themselves throw the phone into water and see what happens.
Exactly. How many employees would do it? Very, very few.
It's his own work. He would not be planning to be sure.
It is very, very few people who are willing to be that honest with yourself. And that's where I believe that this whole survival thing is real. We've got to live with it. But I'm not saying that we cannot go to the place where you're saying is ideal. But to that, you have to go through all of this.
Think about just failing at very early stages and encouraging failure at stages where it actually doesn't hurt as much as the example that you had right now. Because like if you actually encourage that, people building maybe prototypes that are much cheaper than the prototype you throw on the water and stuff like that, you know? Actually people are then, they wouldn't make these mistakes to begin with, you know, in an extended
sense. Well, I think they are two different things.
Yeah.
Because see, I take the phone, I put it in water, and it doesn't work. I don't fire all of them, right? I
go back and work on it.
I make it better. So it's not that okay, you made a mistake, you're out of the company, you're a hopeless engineer. It's not okay. I'm just pushing the boundary. I'm saying that okay, this is not something that you have thought. Please go and work on it again. I'm not saying I'm. In fact,
I have.
I think,
dude,
the
I've got to say
the difference
this.
Is, you're talking about feeling. I have this.
Yeah, it's
I'm talking about feeling. I'm talking about investing time and money. So if you invest 1 week work or 1 year of work and then throw it in the fish tank, so it's like feeling.
You want to look at it from the perspective of the engineer, saying the engineer says, "Oh, my 1 year's work has gone into the." He's gone into the water and he's going to feel bad.
No, I'm not talking about feelings.
Personal.
I'm talking about his time and his payment that he received in that year, and that even for Steve Jobs is an investment that he made.
Right.
So does he want to make an investment for 1 week and test something for 1 week instead of just letting somebody work blindly for 1 year and then...
No, so
technology challenges take a year to work on.
Yeah, to
pay. At the end of the year, you'll still find that it doesn't work as well. There's another Apple story about the glass. I mean, the touchscreen, he put it in his pocket with his car keys and he said that, you know, it would crash. You go and buy just find someone with better glass. And see, he's just making the product better. And if he's going to sit there and think that how his engineers are going to feel we are not going to get... It's more of a principle, the principle of perfection, rather than how the engineer feels.
Exactly.
Now, you can look at it from this way.
I'm not talking about feeling. I don't care about that. I care about investments that you make and the time that
He has made it. For example, the touchscreen, the original idea was years ago.
In the 60s, actually. Yeah,
the
first touchscreen was in the 60s.
They had a guy from MIT who did it as part of his master's thesis. They tried it out. It was not advanced to the way he wanted it. So they just shelved it. So it does happen, though. I mean, it does happen. And then when Steve Jobs came back to Apple, he said, okay, now the time is ripe for us to look at the technology again, because processes are faster, it's cheaper, and probably we'll have enough computation power to do all this stuff. So let's take that out from the shelf again, and I mean, from the stuff. So I think it does happen. Even if you have a brutally honest...
Can I just give you an example from how the Google Glasses were developed? Okay?
Come on.
Like, and that's why, like, it's like, it's really not about like how people feel, it's not more about like how people actually work and develop their stuff. So it's like, the guy who developed the Google Glasses, his first testings were with, like, I think a string and a paperclip and some, and two computer screens or stuff. And he built something where he could, you know, where with that string and the paperclip, I'm not an engineer, obviously, so his movements would be tracked by the computers. So that took him like 45 minutes to build, and he could collect feedback right away, and then develop further. If you have that kind of working mode, then, you know, you have much smaller steps and can make much...
Can I just add to that? It takes... Creativity is allowing creativity in the workplace is expensive. I would like to have seen Google try something like this out.
How much is a paperclip?
Google try something like putting a Google Glass into production in 98. Not possible. You are surviving at that time. And that's what I'm talking about. You've got to remember the things that helped you move. And for example, Google was disruption. Let's take a market, flip it around.
So
okay,
what is your point against brutal honesty?
That was two different things. Brutal honesty, I'm just personally against it. I think it's very disencouraging, and
I'm sorry. A product like this, a ridiculously thin laptop like this, would not have been possible without brutal honesty.
I think the success of Apple is because the biggest critic was inside the company.
Oh yeah, exactly. And he would break down it, like. In fact, Steve Jobs pushed it at many, many places. He would fire people who didn't have security locks on their iPhones. That's ridiculous, right? That's bad. That's bad. That's not just brutal honesty. That's mean, right?
I think from all that is said about Apple, it's a terrible place to work if you want to be happy.
Yeah. But if you want to do great work, that's the place for you. Yeah.
There's a lot of this. Gawker actually lives on the resentment of Apple. Gawker.com actually lives on resentment of people who work at Apple.
Who are listening to John Mayer here? The musician, right? Do you think Continuum, the record that he wrote, Continuum, was his best record ever, right? The multi-platinum winning record, he won 3 Grammys for that and all that. Do you know when he took that record and went to the manager, he said, I don't see any hits on it. Do you know what that does to an artist who spent 3 years writing that album? And when he goes to the manager, record manager, he's like, I don't see any hits on it. That pushed him harder, and he wrote Gravity after that song, which was probably till date one of his best written songs in the world. I still believe that brutal honesty is a very important part of an organizational culture if you're building a startup. If you're big and you realize that you can afford a little less of being brutally in the face, then go ahead. You can make, and if that works for you, happy employees work for you, do that.
You should probably add something. It's probably in the tech world it works, because we are,
Have you been to a machine lathe?
No.
Jeez, the kind of things that get thrown at you there is horrible. Like, if your error percentage is 0.00001 millimeters, you are anything off that, you're considered worthless as an engineer.
So since the numbers are involved, you can afford to be brutally honest, because
yep.
You'll probably be backed by numbers.
Again, I'm going to make a very personal statement that no, I'm not. But again, I think we come from different worlds, and it's perfectly fine. We all strive to be where you are, but to get there, I'm a big advocate that this has to be done.
I'm telling you, the startups that are playing right now, playing and not surviving and whatever.
You have to get into the shoes of the entrepreneur for that.
I've worked at a startup and I've seen how it can work, how you can actually work. Earn money in a place
where was this?
Like, I mean, SAP is working with design thinking, right? That is part of their
Yep.
Understood. So SAP can do that. This is a huge company.
So SAP can do that. Yeah. So you can teach other people how to actually include a way of design thinking, which is not at all a feeling thing, way of working into your own startup. I've seen startups that are being built based on the principles of design thinking. And
what's the point? What's your point?
It's an iterative work mode where you want to like invest as little resources as possible.
No, I know what design thinking is. I'm asking what's the point. What's
the point of it is, if you, like for example, in the startup that I work at, we had that working principle. So my boss told me, like, make all the mistakes you can, but just make them once and learn from it, right?
They were backed by SAP?
No,
so they were a self-funded company?
Yeah, they were self-funded.
And where was this company? Which?
Of course, I'm German, I'm from Berlin. So, but still, I mean, it's the same everywhere. I mean, if you're depending on your own cash flow, you have to make money. In an Indian environment or in a German environment, it doesn't really matter.
It does.
It does.
It does.
We are a land of jugaad. Germany is known for its engineering. Please.
And its perfection.
Germany is known for its...
I'd like to just pitch in. So I'm working for a German person settled in India. So I kind of fall in both ways that we are enjoying inside.
But
even though we are in India and we're in a very tight business, we are enjoying our time inside in many different ways compared to an Indian company run by an Indian in the same sector, everything same, the way things are run there. So.
Good man, I'm really. Wait, let me finish. Wait, no, you wait.
Maru ke dande.
Khatam kar dam.
So, tea coffee is being served at Astrid. So, whenever you want to walk out of this session, you can.
But thank you so much, guys. This is probably the best audience I've had in all of my bar camps.
Least visual, I guess so.
Dude, this is brutal, man.
Last time they didn't see them.
There was a lot of brutal honesty here. But I'm glad. I hope I kind of put forth what I've seen as culture to all of you, and maybe that'll help you someday. Thanks so much.